Hello students, today we are dealing with the concept psychosis. We all know that there are different deviations in behavior. These deviations can be termed as abnormal. When we see the variety of abnormal behaviors that exist among the people, the most important are neurotic, psychotic, psychosomatic, antisocial personality, substance abuse disorders, and cognitive disorders. Let us confine today to understand what is the concept of psychosis, why it occurs, what are the signs and symptoms, and can we treat the psychosis. The term psychosis refers to an abnormal condition of the mind, and it is a generic psychiatric term for a mental state often described as involving loss of contact with reality. People suffering from psychosis are described as psychotic. In fact, psychosis is the term given to the more severe form of psychiatric disorder during which hallucinations, delusions, gross excitement or stupor and impaired insight may occur. The term psychosis is very broad and it can mean anything from relatively normal aberrant experiences through to the complex and catatonic expressions of schizophrenia and bipolar type 1 disorder. Moreover, a wide variety of central nervous system diseases from both external substances and internal physiological illnesses can produce symptoms of psychosis. In fact, this led many professionals to say that psychosis is not specific enough as a diagnostic term. Despite this, the term psychosis is generally used to noticeable deficits in normal behavior, that is negative signs, and more commonly to diverse types of hallucinations or delusional beliefs. For example, the delusional beliefs like grandiosity, delusions of persecution, delusions of reference. Someone exhibiting very obvious signs may be described as frankly psychotic, whereas the other person who exhibits very subtle signs could be classified in the category of an attenuated psychotic risk syndrome. People experiencing psychosis may exhibit some personality changes and also thought disorders. Depending on the severity, this may be accompanied by unusual behavior as well as difficulty with social interaction and impairment in carrying out daily life activities. Once we have understood what is the concept of psychosis, how can we identify? Are there any symptoms? Are there any signs based upon that which we can feel that the person is suffering from psychotic disorders? Like any other disorder, there are certain prominent signs and symptoms based upon which we can say that the person is suffering from psychotic disorders. People with psychosis may have one or more of the following symptoms. The symptoms include hallucinations, delusions, catatonia or a thought disorder, and impairments in social cognition. Now, what do you mean by hallucination? We all know that there are two different deviations or abnormalities in perception, that is illusion and hallucination. So, this hallucination is very prominently seen among the psychotic patients. A hallucination is defined as sensory perception in the absence of external stimuli. These hallucinations may occur in any of the five senses and they can take any form, which may include simple sensations such as lights, colors, tastes and smells, extending to the experiences such as seeing and interacting with fully formed animals and people, hearing voices and having complex tactile sensations. There are number of variety of hallucinations. Auditory hallucinations, for example, are more prominent compared to the other variety of hallucinations. These auditory hallucinations are nothing but particularly experiences like hearing voices, which is a very common and prominent feature of psychosis. Hallucinated voices may talk about or to the person and may involve several speakers with distinct personas. Auditory hallucinations tend to be particularly distressing when they are derogatory, commanding, or preoccupying. However, the experience of hearing voices need not always be a negative one. Whether it is normal hallucination or whether it is a deviation and can be considered as a symptom of psychotic, it depends upon how frequently and how intensely the person is experiencing it. Now, what is the next symptom that is more prominent among the psychotic patients? After the hallucinations, the second place is occupied by the delusions. Delusions are nothing but false beliefs, and sometimes these beliefs are paranoid in nature. These beliefs are generally held by the people in spite of the contrary evidence to what they believe. However, it is very difficult to change their belief though we try to show the evidence. The general common themes of delusions are persecutory, that is, a person who is suffering with this persecutory delusion believes that others are planning to harm him, or sometimes the delusions can be grandiose, that is, a person who is exhibiting this delusion of grandeur, he feels that he has a special power or skill to influence the people around or to bring about a change in the society. Depressed persons may have delusions consistent with their low mood. For example, delusions like that they have done some sin or they have contracted a serious illness. So, these are some of the common delusions which people experience when they are under the psychotic disorder. Carl Jaspers has classified psychotic delusions into primary and secondary types. Primary delusions are nothing but they arise suddenly and not comprehensible in terms of normal mental processes. Whereas, secondary delusions may be understood as being influenced by the person's background or current situation. For example, the factors like ethnicity, religious beliefs, superstitious beliefs may influence the person's perception. The third symptom, which is another prominent symptom, is catatonia. Catatonia describes a profoundly agitated state in which the experience of reality is generally considered to be impaired. There are two primary manifestations of catatonic behavior. The classic presentation is a person who does not move or interact with the world in a way while awake. So, they are just remain stable without any movement. This type of catatonia presents with waxy flexibility. Waxy flexibility is when someone physically moves part of a catatonic person's body and the person stays in the position even if it is abnormal and otherwise non-functional. For example, moving a person's arm straight up in the air and the arm stays there. He doesn't move the arm. Generally, like when we raise the hand, when we raise the arm, we try to bring it down after a while. But these people do not make such attempt. The other type of catatonia is more of an outward presentation of the profoundly agitated state. It involves, unlike the earlier type, excessive and purposeless motor movements, as well as mental preoccupation, which prevents intact experience or reality. For example, someone walking very fast in circles to the exclusion of anything else with a level of mental preoccupation which was not typical of the person prior to the symptom onset. In both types of catatonia, there is generally no reaction to anything that happens outside to them, they just remain in whichever position they are. It is important to distinguish catatonic agitation from severe bipolar mania, although someone could have both. The another symptom which is present in psychotic disorders is thought disorder. Thought disorder describes an underlying disturbance to conscious thought and is classified largely by its effects on speech and writing. Affected persons show loosening of associations, that is, a disconnection and disorganization of the semantic content of speech and writing. That is, whatever they speak, there is no coherence in that, it is not organized. And in the severe form, the speech becomes incomprehensible and it is known as word salad. It's a mixture of words rather than the words which make any sense. So, the word salad is very much prominent among the psychotic disordered patients. Once we understood what is psychosis, after understanding the signs and symptoms of psychosis, like any other disorder, we are curious to know what makes the people develop the psychotic disorders. What are the factors that lead to the development of psychotic disorders? The DSM-4-TR lists causes of psychotic illnesses as psychosis due to general medical conditions and substance-induced psychosis. Mainly, the psychosis was divided into two types: organic psychosis, if it is caused due to some organic impairment, and functional psychosis, if the disorder has developed due to the traumatic events or due to the psychological problems. But now that classification was dropped, and the current classification of the DSM-4-TR has been used. So, here the psychotic disorder, as per the DSM-4-TR, it could be because of substance abuse or it could be because of general medical conditions. Sometimes, even under the normal states, some of us may exhibit some symptoms of psychosis, but definitely we cannot label them as suffering with the psychotic disorders unless it is properly diagnosed. So, now let us see what are these causes in general. Primary psychiatric causes of psychosis include the following conditions. Psychosis can occur because of schizophrenia and schizophreniform disorder. It can also occur because of affective disorders, that is, mood disorders, which include severe depression and severe depression or mania in bipolar disorder, that is, manic depression. People experiencing a psychotic episode in the context of depression may experience persecutory or self-blaming delusions or hallucinations, while people experiencing a psychotic episode in the context of mania may form grandiose delusions. Psychosis can also occur because of schizoaffective disorder, which involves symptoms of both schizophrenia and mood disorders. Brief psychotic disorder or acute transient psychotic disorder is also the reason for the people suffering with psychosis. Delusional disorder or persistent delusional disorder is another situation where we see the people showing the symptoms of psychosis. Chronic hallucinatory psychosis is another factor wherein leading to the development of psychotic symptoms. Apart from this, psychotic symptoms may also be seen in the following conditions, like schizotypal disorder, sometimes personality disorders which occur because of the stress, for example, paranoid personality disorder, schizoid personality disorder, and borderline personality disorder. Major depressive disorder in its severe form, although it is possible and more likely to have severe depression without psychosis. Bipolar disorder in severe mania and severe depression, although it is possible to have severe mania and severe depression without psychosis. Sometimes we see this condition very frequently. Post-traumatic stress disorder is also the situation wherein we see the psychotic symptoms among the patients. Induced delusional disorder is another situation where we can come across the symptoms of psychosis. Sometimes in severe obsessive compulsive disorder also they exhibit the symptoms of psychosis, but this is a very rare case because most often obsessive compulsive disorder is a neurotic disorder, but sometimes in certain cases it is accompanied by the psychotic symptoms. Stress is also found to contribute to the psychotic states. A history of psychologically traumatic events or the recent experience of a stressful event, both of them can contribute to the development of psychosis. Short-lived psychosis triggered by stress is known as brief reactive psychosis, and the patient generally recovers within 2 weeks. But in rare cases, individuals may remain in a state of full-blown psychosis for many years or perhaps have attenuated psychotic symptoms like low intensity hallucinations, which are present at most times. It is surprising to note that B12 deficiency can sometimes cause the psychosis and mania. However, most hospitals and mental facilities do not check for B12 deficiencies. Apart from these psychiatric factors or the situations, sometimes even under the normal states, for some reasons, we do see the psychotic symptoms among the people. What are those situations? Brief hallucinations are common in those without any psychiatric disease. Causes or triggers include falling asleep and waking, which is known as hypnagogic and hypnopompic hallucinations, which are entirely normal. They cannot be called as deviations. Secondly, bereavement, in which hallucinations of a diseased loved one are common. Next factor is severe sleep deprivation, which leads to exhibition of the psychotic symptoms. Sensory deprivation and sensory impairment also are the reasons wherein the person can experience psychotic symptoms. Caffeine intoxication and stressful events are the other normal states where the person can experience the symptoms of psychosis. Now, what are the medical conditions which may influence the occurrence of the psychotic symptoms? A very large number of medical conditions can cause psychosis, sometimes called as secondary psychosis. For example, disorders causing delirium, which is known as toxic psychosis, in which consciousness is disturbed. Similarly, a person suffering with neurodevelopmental disorders and chromosomal abnormalities may also show the symptoms of psychosis. Neurodegenerative disorders like Alzheimer's, dementia, and Parkinson's disease. Under these situations, also people experience psychotic symptoms. Focal neurological disease like stroke, brain tumors, multiple sclerosis, and some forms of epilepsy contribute to the development of psychotic symptoms. Apart from all this, malignancy, that is typically via masses in the brain, paraneoplastic syndromes or drugs used to treat cancer. So, this is another situation which leads to the occurrence of the psychotic symptoms. Infectious and post-infectious syndromes, including infections causing delirium, viral encephalitis, HIV, malaria, Lyme disease, and syphilis. Under these conditions, also there is a probability that some patients do experience symptoms of psychosis. We cannot underestimate the role of endocrine diseases like hypo and hyperthyroidism, adrenal failure, Cushing syndrome, sex hormones, All these things affect psychotic symptoms, and sometimes childbirth can provoke psychosis termed as puerperal psychosis. In some cases, we see the inborn errors of metabolism that lead to the exhibition of psychotic symptoms. Nutritional deficiencies such as vitamin B12 and other acquired metabolic disorders and failure of the liver or kidneys also contribute to the development of psychotic symptoms among the patients. There are innumerable medical disorders or innumerable medical conditions which influence the onset of psychotic symptoms. Some of them include autoimmune and related disorders, poisoning by therapeutic drugs, recreational drugs, and a range of plants, fungi, metals, organic compounds, and a few animal toxins. All these factors are responsible for the development of psychotic symptoms. Some sleep disorders like hallucinations in narcolepsy. This is also a situation wherein the person experiences the symptoms of psychosis. Psychosis can even be caused by familiar ailments like flu or mumps. The other reason or the other cause that may lead to the development of psychosis is substance abuse. Substance abuse induced psychosis is another cause wherein we see the usage or the abuse of alcohol, drugs lead to the development of the symptoms of psychosis among the addicts. Various psychoactive substances, both legal and illegal, have been implicated in causing, exacerbating, and precipitating psychotic states and disorders in users. This may be upon intoxication for a more prolonged period after use or upon withdrawal. Individuals who have a substance-induced psychosis tend to have a greater awareness of their psychosis and tend to have higher levels of suicidal thinking compared to individuals who have a primary psychotic illness. Drugs that can induce psychotic symptoms include cannabis, cocaine, amphetamines, ketones, psychedelic drugs such as LSD, K-opioid receptor agonists, and NMDA receptor antagonists. Once we have understood the situations which lead to the development of the symptoms of psychosis, how do we diagnose it? Diagnosing the presence or the extent of psychosis may be distinguished from diagnosing the cause of psychosis. The presence of psychosis is typically diagnosed by clinical interview incorporating a mental state examination. This can be done by using certain rating scales. The most prominently used rating scale is BPRS, which means Brief Psychiatric Rating Scale. This scale assesses the level of 18 symptom constructs of psychosis such as hostility, suspicion, hallucination, and grandiosity. The diagnosis can also be based on the clinician's interview with the patient and observations of the patient's behavior over the previous 2 to 3 days. The patient's family can also provide the behavior report. During the initial assessment and the follow-up, both positive and negative symptoms of psychosis can be assessed by using the scale Positive and Negative Symptom Scale, which is shortly called as PANSS, that is PANSS. Establishing the cause of psychosis requires not only the clinical examination but sometimes special investigations to diagnose or exclude secondary causes of psychosis. If these are excluded, a primary psychiatric diagnosis can be established. Once we understood the diagnosis, now what is the treatment? The treatment depends on the cause or diagnosis, that is whether it has occurred, that is the symptoms of psychosis occurred either because of schizophrenia or bipolar or substance intoxication. Generally, the first line treatment for many psychotic disorders is antipsychotic medication. and sometimes hospitalization is also needed. There is growing evidence that cognitive behavior therapy and family therapy can be effective in managing psychotic symptoms. When other treatments of psychosis are ineffective, then we have to rely on electroconvulsive therapy, or popularly known as ECT or shock treatment, is sometimes used to relieve the underlying symptoms of psychosis due to depression. There is also increasing research suggesting that animal-assisted therapy can contribute to the improvement in general well-being of people with schizophrenia. However, always more than the treatment, early intervention is very much essential in order to bring about changes in the patients. This early intervention is relatively a new concept as far as psychosis is concerned. And this intervention is based on the observation that identifying and treating someone in the early stages of a psychosis can significantly improve their longer term outcome. This approach advocates the use of an intensive multidisciplinary approach, which we call it as critical period, where intervention is most effective and prevents the long term morbidity associated with chronic psychotic illness. The current research into the effectiveness of cognitive behavioral therapy during the early precursory stages of psychosis, also known as the prodrome or at-risk mental state, suggests that such input can prevent or delay the onset of psychosis.